It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come.
This is talkSPORT Breakfast with Alan Brazil and Ali McCoist.
So, trouble all over the world at the moment, but in America, dear oh dear, the Black Lives Matter protests continued all over the world yesterday after security guard George Floyd died after a white police officer knelt on his neck last week. His death sparked global protests against racism, police brutality throughout the Black Lives Matter campaign. Let's catch up more. Here's talkSPORT's Jenny Barsby.
The tragic and traumatic death of George Floyd at the hands of police over in the US has sent shockwaves across the globe, and sport is no different. We've already seen protests on the pitch in the Bundesliga and online activity from the majority of sports stars in the UK. TalkSport's reflected on the scenes over the past few days. Former Palace striker Clinton Morrison was alongside Jim White and Natalie Sawyer yesterday and spoke an important message.
I'm sick and tired of talking about racism and people saying about racism and nothing being done about it. Now West people are starting to listen, and why can't these players like Jadon Sancho go onto the pitch and say Black Lives Matter? Because it does matter. It does matter. We always just say, oh, there's another black person dying. We all bleed the same colour, black, brown, white. We're all together. We're all trying to stand together. We're all human beings, and we still bleed the same. And all red blood comes out of us when we're bleeding. So when people come on and they message in and say something, why are we talking about racism? The reason we're talking about racism because it needs to be addressed. What's happening in America and stuff like, it's an absolute disgrace, and I've got kids of my own and stuff like that. So if people, I can come on here and I can say what I want to say, because I'm worried about what could happen to my kids. I'm worried about my other family members and stuff like that, and it could happen to me. I've been stopped many a time, so I know I could say a bit here, Jim. I was going off the subject, but that kind of hit home to me hard there, because people are saying, oh, we're always talking about racism. I have to come out and tell you, we have to talk about it.
Former Spurs striker Darren Bent was on the breakfast show yesterday, and he told TalkSport about his own experiences with racism.
How am I supposed to try and educate my children to say, well, listen, you might be like, Milan, who's the oldest, he's six, like, he's a lovely little boy, always full of energy, full of life. And I think to myself, how can I try and tell him and educate him, like, listen, even though you're a lovely kid, you're well-mannered, someone might not like you just because of the colour of your skin. Like, how can I explain that to him? How is he going to understand that? That's where, obviously, where they're going to grow up being guarded, and that's how they're going to have to be. You have to show them where black people are coming from, unfortunately. And this is what, unfortunately, you've got to kind of toughen them up. Like, this situation might happen to you. Like, it's an extreme situation, but listen, that's the kind of day we live in. And when it comes to hashtags and stuff, yeah, it's all well and good, but is that going to change anything? Because obviously there was a whole blackout screen that was going on yesterday, and then someone sent me a tweet, and it said, blacking out your screen and not posting for a day is historically a mistake. During the apartheid in South Africa, they cut off radio communications to stop uprisings in different parts of the country. So in a ploy to slow down US tensions, they use groupthink model to tell us to black out, which is, so, do you know what I mean? So there's a conspiracy around everything. So I think unless you show the kids this is what you could face, honestly, it's a long, long road ahead. And I said, we're talking about 30 years now. Since the whole Rodney King thing, things have got no better.
6:26 now. Robert Earnshaw played in the MLS in America and Canada between 2013-2015 for Toronto, Chicago Fire and Vancouver Whitecaps, and I played out there in 78. But Robert is now back in the UK, and I'm delighted to say Robert joins us now. Robert, good morning. How are we, Robert?
Good morning, gentlemen. How are you?
Very well, apart from, well, the last few days have been hell to watch telly or listen to radio, what's going on. Robert, I just go back to 1978. I went out to Detroit, and I was out there for probably about 12, 14 weeks, just to sort of, I went at a funny time. I went as a kid to gain experience and play throughout the summer. And, do you know, during the games, I was trying to rack my brains over the past few days, thinking how bad was out there for some of the black guys playing. And I always remember one guy, I think he played for Colorado, Caribou, and they had like a cowboy top on. This was a South African guy. What a player he was. A guy called Jomo Somo. And there was another guy as well, Ace someone. He was a much sort of thinner elegant player on the ball, a black guy as well, South African, and they were fantastic. The crowd absolutely loved them. I was trying to rack my brains about when we played in certain parts, you know, was there clear and horrible racist stuff coming from the crowds? And I'll be honest with you, there's nothing really stood out. Now, clearly there's a problem there, but I didn't see it in 78, which is weird. I'm just thinking your time in the States, Robert, did you enjoy it, or did you come across horrible people?
Yeah, I mean, listen, I think I'm not the only one, and I won't be the only one. I've had times, when you say, you know, when you went out there and you did, it was there, but not too much. I don't think it's too much. I think we've definitely progressed on the football pitch, because, you know, I've had it in this country when I was young. And, you know, now when I've played out there, I've never really had it on the pitch out there. And it's not something that's been there. I've had it more off the pitch.
Yeah.
I think more in society, more out there. I mean, for instance, there was a time a couple of years ago I was living out there, I had a neighbor who was pretty much directly being racist. You know, saying that it was a time, you know, now's almost a good time to be in America or not to be in America, I guess, just because of, you know, the president that was there. And that was what she was insinuating, and kept knocking my door because I was walking too much upstairs after a certain time. I mean, how are you supposed to, what are you supposed to do? Not walk. I mean, But the thing was, it was a hidden message behind it. I think that was the key. It was a hidden message behind, you know, I don't like what you're doing because of you. And that was the thing. Yeah. And that's, I mean, there's a few instances, and I think people go through it all the time. And, you know, I think sometimes where, you know, I was in America and, you know, a couple of times you get stopped by police for, you know, for instance, you didn't signal or something, you know, something very minor, day to day, it's normal, you know, something that happens, a little small little mistake, and you think, okay, you know, is this going to go bad? That was the moment, those moments were the times where I was like, I shouldn't be thinking that. That shouldn't be something, that shouldn't be even a thought. It should be, this happened, that happened, okay, and we go about our day, he's doing his job, we move on. And, you know, listen, nothing ever happened from it. There was no racism, there was nothing like that. But it was the point that I thought about it because of what you see. And, I mean, you see these things over the last few days, and that's why you think about it. Because, but to be honest, not too much on the pitch, and I think there's definitely been a progression. There's definitely been an improvement, and I think it's been years and started to be done over years, but we're still not there, and that's the key. Mm.
Robert, I was going to ask you, mate, I always remember we had the fantastically talented, and I know you'll know of him, I don't know if you played with him or against him, Mark Walters came up to mm-hmm. Rangers, and he was faced with some absolutely horrendous racism at some of the away grounds. I mean, it was absolutely shocking. And I've got to say, to Mark's credit, Robert, I've never, you know, I don't know actually, and I'll never know how it affected him internally, but externally, he was absolutely magnificent. He really was. It was just a shout, a tower of strength. He didn't let it bother him. It certainly didn't look as though he let it bother him at all. He knew, mm-hmm. he clearly knew he had the backing of all of his teammates in the dressing room. But how important is it to show that inner strength? Because I was going to say to you, and I think I agree with you. It's one of these subjects you've got to be clearly very careful how you speak about it, because I've never suffered racism of any degree, Robert. So it's a difficult subject for me to have any real knowledge about. I appreciate how terrible it is and how wrong it is, and I get that. But I was asking, it was interesting as well to listen to yourself there. Do you think it is getting better? Because I look at my kids, for example, and their pals, and they don't care. They've got absolutely no idea about any of what colour of skin or what religion they're into. And surely, and I think we're all in agreement, that is the way we want our kids to be brought up and move forward.
Yeah, and do you know, you're right. And it's, and I know there'll be a lot of people listening, and there'll be a lot of people out there that will be in the same shoes as you, Ali, and they don't go through it. And it's not a second thought, and it's not there. I do believe it's going forward. I believe it's something that is something that is there, and I think it will improve, will get better. And it's something I think you have to pass on. You have to pass on a better message. And I think that's the key. You have to pass on a better message because it's not been working. You know, for hundreds of years. You're talking hundreds of years. And I think you're starting to see a light. I think because of these protests, and what they are is protests. I think the people breaking into shops and looters and things like that, that's a completely different thing. That's not even part of it. The protesters, the people lying down in America now, and I saw, you know, it's traveling now. It's traveling across the world. In France, I saw yesterday there's protesters just based on we're going to march based on we want a change of this. This is not part of the human race. And I always say, you know, it's one human race. And that's the key.
Yeah.
It's one human race. It's not, you know, you have to differentiate between this and you're Muslim, you're Chinese, you're yellow, black, gray, you know, white, whatever it is. I think we have to give the message. And the message is the next guy is the next guy. It's not about what the pigment of their skin is. You know, that's got nothing to do with it. And I think it's definitely been an adjustment for people, I think, over the last few days. But I think what's happening is it's just revealing. It's revealing what's already there. And I think what the positive thing is to your question, I've seen a lot of completely, you know, all different colors coming in and marching. And it's powerful. I think it's very, very powerful. And I think that's when you protest, when you stand up and say, this is not the way forward. This is not the way we want to go forward. We want to go forward in a better way. And there's every kind of person there marching. I think that's the best thing, and that's the most powerful thing that I'm seeing. Because this comes from generations, and the messages in the generations, this is where it comes from. And you have to understand, you know, humans, there's love and there's hate, and the hate comes from different angles. And part of that is being pointing at the things that they see with their eyes. It's a different color skin to me, and that's where all of these things have done, and it's generations and generations and the actions of people before. So we have to change that. We have to move on. We have to move forward and identify it. And I think the key has been identifying it, and part of the protest is identifying this is happening all the time.
Yeah.
Because now we can, you know, I can come on here and speak about it. And, you know, there's a few more people that learn about it. And say, oh, yeah, hold on. Yeah, that's right. People are going through this. People I know are going through this. And listen, this happens all the time. I mean, I've gone through it, and I've gone through it in different countries, not just in America, by the way. This is not a thing for just in America. It's actually all over. I've been to Yugoslavia. I've been to Italy. I've been to Spain. I've been to in the UK here. And we can't think it's somewhere else. It's everywhere. I've been to all those countries and faced racism.
Yeah.
And during football.
Well, Eastern Europe football. As well, Robert. You're right. You know, some of the young England boys will tell you that. Robert, I've got to break, mate, because I'm way over time. Great to talk to you again, Robert. Take care. Speak later. Thank you. Robert Earnshaw there, who's played in Canada, America, all over. Okay, up next we're talking about Project Restart.
I was born by the river in a little tent. Oh, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come.